All right. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Spencer Brown, and I have the privilege of serving as a spokesman for Young America's Foundation, helping to share the stories of what you all are doing on your campuses, on the crazy things that leftists are doing to try to shut down your bold advancement of conservative ideas. And I think if there's one thing to be hopeful of, it's that the startling state of college campuses is becoming more and more clear every day. Liberal administrators, through their tactics, have turned what were once incubators of critical thinking into indoctrination centers where conservative speech is equated with violence, and the rioting students are applauded as bold, brave heroes rather than made to face the consequences of their actions. Young America's Foundation today is uniquely positioned as the only organization that pairs legal advocacy for students with on-the-ground campus activism programs. When conservative students, many of you here have gone through this, are working with us to host conservative speakers or put on bold activism projects on your campus, and you come up against these bureaucratic roadblocks, mobs of violent leftists, or outright unconstitutional suppression of your ideas, Young America's Foundation is ready to help you defend them. Here today to talk about what students and concerned citizens alike can do to defend free speech and advance conservative ideas among the rising generation is Young America's Foundation's Associate General Counsel, Mark Trammell. Mark has dedicated his career to advocating for robust First Amendment freedoms, limited government, and individual liberties. At YAF, this takes many forms, including dealing with many of my questions every day about what is legal and what is not legal. But his main job that I work with him on is Young America's Foundation's new Censorship Exposed project that reveals the internal workings of liberal institutions. In addition to his work at YAF, Mark serves as an adjunct professor at Liberty University, and he's here to break down some of the craziness we've seen unfold at schools around the country this year, and what YAF is doing, and what we've accomplished in championing the rights of students when they come under fire. Please join me in giving a warm YAF welcome to Mark Trammell.
All right. Thank you, Spencer, for that introduction, and It's very true and very telling what he said. Spencer mentioned that he comes to me a lot and says, you know, is this legal? And the answer is usually no. No, you cannot post that online. That's a daily occurrence in our office, and it's a lot of fun. But I'm thrilled to be here today. My name is Mark Trammell. I'm the Associate General Counsel here at Young America's Foundation. I work very closely with Kimberly Beck. She's in the back. She's our General Counsel. And together, we work with the rest of our legal team to defend students' rights. And before I jump too far into my presentation, there's one thing that I want to highlight. It's a theme that I think you'll find consistent throughout my remarks. And that's the idea that students have rights. Okay, this might be groundbreaking for some, hopefully not in this room, but you have rights. Every one of you has rights. And these rights were not conjured up by your dean or your professors. They didn't give it to you as a gift. They're not these benevolent authoritarian dictators that just gave you the right to speak. You actually possessed that like long before you came to campus. The Declaration of Independence is clear, right? You were endowed by your creator with certain inalienable rights, among them the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And so today's presentation is really focusing on these liberty rights, okay? And really specifically, I want to talk primarily about your rights under the First Amendment on your campus. So you have the freedom of speech. So this means, this is awesome, okay? This means that you can say pretty much whatever you want on campus, okay? So let that sink in for a minute, because you're told all the time, you shouldn't say that. That wouldn't be right. You might offend somebody if you say this. But it doesn't mean you can't say it. You should. If you believe it, you should, okay? But it also means, because you have the freedom of speech, it also means you have the freedom not to speak. And sometimes this is every bit as important as the freedom to say what's on your mind, is the freedom not to say something that goes against your beliefs or that grieves your conscience. You have the freedom of religion. On campus, you can be as private or as public about your faith as you desire. You have the freedom of the press. You have the freedom of assembly. Now, this really gets administrators nervous, okay? When conservatives start assembling together, getting together, talking about conservative ideas. So this means that you can form associations, you can form clubs that are based upon a shared belief. You can work together with other students towards a common goal. at your university, especially if your university is a public university, okay, as a government actor, your university has the responsibility to protect these freedoms. It cannot violate the freedoms. But even those who rarely watch a news program, who rarely read a newspaper or log on to social media, I admit I don't have Facebook, but even I can tell you that freedom is under assault on college campuses. And who can miss it, right? I mean, the images of riots and protesters at Berkeley, at Middlebury, at Claremont, at Cal State, Los Angeles, these are images that are hard to forget. I think we have any CSULA students here?
Woo-hoo!
All right. That's awesome. Welcome, guys. All right, give it up for CSULA, because this is a great chapter right here. Okay, in all of these situations, protesters attempted to silence conservative speakers by intimidation, by a show of force, right? And they did so all on the basis of viewpoint, because they fundamentally disagreed with what you said. They erroneously deemed your ideas dangerous, hateful, and violent. But this vitriol intolerance of conservative thinking is a derivative, of conservative thinking, and by derivative, this hostility towards students is not faculty-led. Or I'm sorry, it's not student-led, it's faculty-led. This is the product of radical leftist administrators, and they're treating college campuses as personal mini kingdoms where only ideas that please them are allowed, and where education is synonymous with indoctrination. Unfortunately, students bear the brunt of this. Their constitutional rights are ignored, and due process becomes completely non-existent. But thankfully, there is a recourse. So our YAF team is here to help. And in the moments we have together, I want to talk about several examples of students who reached out to Young America's Foundation, to our team of attorneys, what we did, and ultimately how we won, okay? Okay, so the first slide we have is from Saddleback. I think we have some students from Saddleback here, right? Over here. Okay, so Saddleback College apparently is a very interesting place. I've never been to your campus, but I can only imagine after reading some of the emails from your professors what they're really like. Okay, so as part of our Censorship Exposed program, which is a newer program here at the Foundation, which is made possible by the generosity of a supporter in Florida, who I think is live streaming the event today, so everyone can wave. But we found out some very interesting things about Saddleback College. Through this new program with the Foundation, what we do is we send public record requests to colleges. All right, so you've heard of the Federal Freedom of Information Act. And that applies to federal agencies, but states also have a parallel law that allow us transparency into our state-funded institutions. And part of that is a college, a state-funded college. So a little bit of background, not this past September, but the September before it, the Saddleback chapter decided to participate in the 9/11 Never Forget Project. Many of you probably participate on this project on your campus. It's a fantastic form of activism, and if you're not doing it, you should, okay? So put it on your calendar for next year. But in sum, what they do is they put 2,977 flags in a memorial display on campus, and each flag represents one of the victims of radical Islamic terrorists in 9/11. So the students put up these flags, and they put up posters all over campus, posters saying, 9/11, never forget. That's all the poster said, 9/11, never forget. And this professor, Margot Lovett, and we have her on video doing it, which is just makes it even better. But Margot takes it upon herself to take down every one of these posters on campus. So she actually approached the students and said, hey, are you guys the ones responsible for these posters? And you know, they said, yeah, we put up these posters, but what's the big deal, right? She informed them that university policy required her to take down the posters. No. And so she not only took down the posters, she crumbled them. She destroyed them. Didn't even give the chapter a chance to put them back up. And she said you didn't follow the rules. You didn't have a stamp from the Associated Student Government, which in our office we kind of joked around, this is like the free speech stamp, right? Like if you have this stamp of approval, then you get free speech rights, but if you don't, you're out of luck. So what we did was we sent a Freedom of Information Act request to the school. Sorry, I've got to pull a Marco Rubio. I don't present very often, so forgive me. But he does, so there's no excuse. I love Marco, though. We have some others that love Marco. All right, little Marco. So we have... Ron, I'm sorry. I hope I still have a job on Monday. So Saddleback College, let's get back to it, right? So we sent this information request, and I asked for emails from Professor Margot Lovett. I asked for emails from the administrators, the dean, the chancellor of the school, and I asked for emails that had a keyword in them. So I wanted, if it said 9/11, if it said Never Forget Project, if it said posters, if it said YAF, like I want that email, and I'm entitled to it as a citizen, as a taxpayer, right? I have the ability as a taxpayer to look and have this transparency into what institutions that I'm funding are doing. So we got this this box of, I think it was like 1,500 pieces of paper, 1,500 documents that they sent. And so I have some real gems to show you. So this first one is an email from Terry, I think your last name is Flugeman. And the way that Saddleback works is there's actually, it's in Orange County, and there's a sister school. And the sister school, there's an overarching district of administrators that work with both campuses. So Terry is part of this overarching district. And so she says, Jeannie McHugh at Saddleback called to notify us that they are dealing with a PR issue over some 9/11 propaganda that was posted without permission in a non-designated area on campus. And as a freedom-loving conservative, this gives me like a heart attack, heartburn. You just want to just give them a remedial lesson on what the First Amendment means. So let's walk through this briefly. This is a PR issue, okay? So they put up signs that said 9/11, never forget, and they put flags in the ground to commemorate lives lost, and this is a PR issue for the school, okay? The attitude and the understanding from the school should be that, oh my goodness, our students' rights were violated. No, that's not where they went with that. Their response is, well, we have a PR issue that now we have to deal with. This doesn't make us look good. So their interest is out of whack to start with. Next, this is 9/11 propaganda. I love the usage of that word. I know what the word propaganda means, but I wanted to look it up just to make sure, confirm my understanding, because it's an odd choice to put in here. So just a reminder, propaganda is information that is biased or misleading, and it's used to achieve a political cause or a point of view. These are flags, right? This is to commemorate those lives that are lost. And this is somehow deemed as propaganda. It was posted without permission. I love that, right? So she just blatantly admits there's a prior restraint on speech here. You have to have a stamp of approval in order to speak. That's unconstitutional. And then she says in a non-designated area on campus, or non-designated R on campus. Yeah. So the idea that you have certain areas of campus that are designated for speech and certain that are not designated for speech, this is also more likely than not unconstitutional, depending on its application. Without getting into the legality of it, you have to have a really awesome reason. And typically, it's a public safety reason, and has to be super narrowly tailored to achieve that in order for you to be able to limit free speech on campus. Let's see. Okay, so on the right, that's Margot Lovett, and I promise, if you're looking at that and you're a little cross-eyed, that's not an issue of the television screen or the photo. Her hair really is that purple. In fact, the folks here from Saddleback, is her hair still that purple?
It's blue.
It's blue.
All right. So So this is an email from Howard Gensler. Now, Howard Gensler is a professor at the school, and at the time, I think he still is, he was the president of the Academic Senate, okay? And Dr. Gensler said, after he wished Margot the best and supported her fully in what she did, by the way, just for context, this is after YAF went public with the video, which was awesome. And news organizations, publications picked it up and broadcasted it, and you know, all of a sudden Margot's everywhere with that purple blue hair. But Dr. Gensler says, a college is its faculty. If you tell students that they are number one, they will run the place. They are not number one. They are guests subsidized by the state and lucky to spend time with faculty like you. Doesn't that make you want to go to Saddleback College? I mean, unbelievable, right? I don't really know what to say about this other than this is just nonsense. It's complete nonsense. But I do want to point out that apparently only students are subsidized by the state with your loans. College professors whose salaries are paid by taxpayers apparently are not subsidized by the state. Again, this is just silly. This is one of my favorite emails. This is from Professor Malarski, Jedrick. We'll just call him Jedrick. Does anyone have Jedrick Malarski?
No. I have Gensler.
You have Gensler. Oh, you should ask him.
Me and him are like this.
Really?
He actually said he supported our club, so now that's kind of a backstab.
You should ask him.
Yeah, I should picture it.
Fantastic. Fantastic. Hey, okay, so this is what I want you to do. After, I'm going to give you my email address. I want you to let me know what he says.
Okay.
Because I'm curious, just for my own, you know, curiosity. Okay, so Jedrick Malarski, this is in a previous email, this is an email chain he has with Margot. In a previous email, he actually criticizes the administration for not removing the 9/11 Never Forget Project flags. So the 2,977 flags that were put on campus. In an email, he says, well, it looks like the YAFers put up the flags even though the university said no. And it looks like they were cowardly in not taking down the flags. So he's not supportive that the university didn't remove the flags. But this email is what really was egregious. He says, eek. What a major pain in the... No, don't say it. Don't say it. I didn't do that to make you say it. Okay? I have a one-year-old daughter at home, so there are certain words that we just don't say in my house. So we replace it with, like, booty or bottom. Okay? So let me just do that. Okay? What a major pain in the booty. They are bigger jack booties than I even imagined, which is really saying a lot. That's Jedrick for you. And if you think, guys, in all seriousness, though, because there's a lot you can laugh about with some of the professors at Saddleback College, but if you think that this is an isolated incident, you'd be mistaken, okay? So this is happening at colleges all across the country, and this is a very new program for us. So I haven't had the opportunity, Kimberly hasn't had the opportunity to dive into necessarily your campus to find out what your administrators, your professors are saying about you behind your back. It's happening. We're gonna keep doing it because it's super important. But it's a process. In 2016, the Washington Times published an article where they surveyed 40, quote, leading universities. They don't name them, but they say they're 40 leading universities. And they said that the ratio of liberal professors to conservative professors on those campuses was 11.5 to 1. And this is looking at all departments. 11.5 liberal, I don't know where they get the half from, that's weird. But 11.5 liberal professors to each conservative. They looked at history departments, this is important stuff. This is how we view history. History departments were exponentially worse. 33.5 liberal professors to each conservative professor. The same year, 2016, in July of 2016, the New York Times published a similar article that was authored by a Sarah Lawrence professor. So not really someone who would be known per se for having Reagan-like conservative beliefs. Okay, Sarah Lawrence, right? She said that colleges in New England states, the ratio was 28 liberal professors to every conservative professor. It's happening everywhere, folks. Another chapter I want to highlight is the University of Alabama. Do we have any? I don't think we have any folks from Alabama here. They're probably gearing up for, you know, the next football game because their school is actually relevant in that conversation. I'm a Terps fan. We're totally not relevant. But anyway, University of Alabama. So this is one of my favorite chapters. Joe Ballard at that chapter interned with us at the foundation this past summer. And if any of y'all are interested in interning, it's a lot of fun. It's a tremendous experience, and we get to work with y'all really, really closely. It's really fantastic. But Joe, he's just to the right of Alan West. Joe worked at the foundation this summer. Joe came to my office one day. We were talking about the state of free speech at the University of Alabama, right? He's telling me stories that are just shocking to me, which is, it says a lot because, we see a lot. You know, we hear a lot of stories from colleges, from all of our chapters. And this was surprising to me. At the University of Alabama, they have a policy that restricts, quote, non-casual speech. I don't know exactly what non-casual speech is, but you can't do it without a permit. Okay, so literally, it's called a ground use permit. So if you want to, and in the policy, they articulate several things that classify without expressly saying what a non-casual speech is. But one of the areas that classifies is if you have printed material, and if you want to distribute printed material on campus, on a sidewalk on campus, on an open-air plaza or on a field on campus, areas that are traditionally afforded the most stringent constitutional protections of speech, areas that are traditionally known as a traditional public forum, you have to get a permit to do so. So you can say, like, hi to your friend, but to do a whole lot more than that, you have to get a permit. So if Joe or any other member of the chapter wants to hand out a constitution on Constitution Day, if they want to hand out a Bible, if they want to hand out an invitation to the YAF chapter meeting, they have to get a permit to do that. So what we did was we have been working with Joe. We enlisted the assistance of outside counsel, and we co-authored a demand letter, which demand letters are actually really fun. I love working on demand letters because it's a threat. I mean, we're making a threat. We're saying, look, if you don't fix this harm, if you don't make this correction, we're going to sue you. I don't know. I grew up watching a lot of Matlock, so it was like a dream come true to be able to send my first demand letter. But this is actually, to the left, there's a photo of it, and then we got some news coverage of it as well. It was actually a fun demand letter to write, because what we did was we kind of played the whole Alabama loves football idea. And so we sent them the letter just before their game with Tennessee. And that's a historical rivalry, not so much as of late. I mean, Tennessee consistently loses to Alabama. It's usually not close. But as if we look at their free speech policy, it's like exponentially better than Alabama. So we kind of just said, like, kind of playfully in the letter, hey, you know, you guys are probably going to destroy Tennessee this week, but just remember, their free speech is way better than yours, and if you don't fix yours, we're going to sue you. And you say it with a smile, and it's, you know, kind of cuts the edge off of it. We also, in addition to sending it to the school, we sent it to the Solicitor General of the state, which is something we hadn't done yet, but it was a new strategy we wanted to employ. We had gotten some feedback from some other Solicitor Generals and Attorney Generals of various states, especially those who were conservative, and they said, well, hey, let us know when these infractions are taking place so we can do what's in our power to fix it, right? So I'm under the impression, I've been told that the Solicitor General of Alabama has now reached out to the new General Counsel of Alabama. Alabama got a new General Counsel in September. So I'm not all that surprised that we haven't heard back from him yet. This was a very recent letter that we sent. But he's already getting phone calls from the Solicitor General about the nonsense that's going on at Alabama. So that's exciting, and it's something that's a work in the process, and it's an example that I think you can look at and think, if there's a similar policy or if your school is violating your rights in a similar way, you know, a strategy that we can employ to secure your freedom of speech as well. All right. SMU. I think we have an SMU student or two. Two, okay. Fantastic. Welcome, guys. Okay, so this is a photo, I think, of some of the chapter, not all the chapter, right? Okay, so some of these folks are members of the SMU chapter. And this is actually a story that got national headlines this year. In sum, what happened was the SMU chapter for the last 2 years has used this really prominent lawn on campus for the 9/11 Never Forget Project. You notice there's a theme here? It's really weird, right? Like, leftists on campus apparently hate patriotism. I don't know. I don't know why, but they do. And so the SMU students were participating in the 9/11 Never Forget Project. They had used the same field the last 2 years, very prominent in front of this picturesque building on campus. And the last 2 years, there was nothing wrong happened. There was no reaction, negative reaction, that is, from the university, from the community. No problems reported at all. Yet the chapter got an email from an administrator saying that if they were to put the flags in the same area, they were worried that it would trigger some students. Now, you guys have probably heard this term on your campus. When I was in school, that wasn't like a thing, which is kind of interesting because it wasn't that long ago. But it's like this new phenomenon that you can't offend somebody. It's kind of what that means. You can't trigger someone. You can't create an emotional response in someone else. I don't know. Again, this is just bizarre. But they said you can't put the flags up because you're going to trigger some. So I think this was like manna from heaven given to Spencer Brown. I think those were his favorite days in the office. I've never seen the guy smile so much. Because it's just a ridiculous story that he got to go on Fox and all these other, you know, nationwide networks and to talk about. And the result of that was in conjunction with Kimberly and I also got the opportunity to call the general counsel and some of the administrators at SMU and kind of point out how ridiculous this is and kind of negotiate a solution. But altogether, the result was a very, very successful 9/11 Never Forget project at Southern Methodist University. You know, and I think it's interesting to note, the students were extraordinarily respectful. That was one thing that struck me, and I think Kimberly will agree, about the students at SMU. They didn't, when they sought redress from their university, they didn't do so with a chip on their shoulder. They were never rude or disrespectful about it. And they didn't have to be, right? Because the facts were on their side. They just pointed out a reality, like, hey, you guys shouldn't be doing this. There's absolutely nothing wrong with this speech. So we had this really successful project here at Southern Methodist University. Let's move on. All right. All right. So our next slide here, University of North Carolina in Greensboro. All right, so we had a recent situation at UNC Greensboro. UNC Greensboro invited, or our conservative students at Greensboro invited Dinesh D'Souza, who is a phenomenal speaker. If you have the chance to invite him to your campus, you totally should. Fantastic speaker. They invited him to speak at Greensboro. And this student did everything right. And I want you to remember that. She did everything right. She followed all the rules. She filled out all the paperwork, went all to the appropriate channels, made sure that every I was dotted, every T was crossed. She did everything right. And the university responded by giving her a contract for the event. So she tried to reserve a facility on campus for her event. And the university said, great, you can have your event. By the way, it's going to cost you over $500 to reserve this room for like a two-hour time block. University policy actually says that they can't do that. University policy says that students, academic departments, are allowed to reserve space for free. They are not charged. So this student, Alanka, pictured here, went to the administrators and she said, hey, what's the deal? I'm a student, full-time student here. I should be able to reserve this space. No problem. There should be no fees. Their response was, well, you're working with Young America's Foundation, so we're going to charge you on this one. Because we think that this is really an America's Foundation event, and we don't really think that this is your event. I mean, how incredibly insulting. This very bright young woman who is doing incredible work, advertising, doing everything right, and her administrators basically told her that she was invisible to them. So Jason Barber on our staff here is an alumni of the school. And so Jason went to the administrators with Alanka as well and talked to them. Again, trying to be reasonable with these folks. And I think that they actually responded by saying, not only did they disagree with us, but then they claimed that they were feeling threatened, which if you know Jason, he's like the most, just the nicest guy you'll ever meet, right? I don't think he's ever said a harsh word to anybody. Just super, super nice. So it's just this ridiculous, ridiculous response from the university. So at the same time, we also looked at the contract, you know, legal, this is what we do. We looked at the contract that the university gave to Alanka for the event. And I want you to see here, it says, is sponsoring the event and is coordinating the usage with fellow licensee Hillary for America. Whoa. So, okay. So a little background. Alanka the whole time has been saying, you guys are treating me like I'm an outsider. You're treating me like I'm Hillary Clinton. When Hillary Clinton came to speak a year prior as a campaign stop. And then we show her this email, this contract, where it literally says Hillary for America. The university really actually, although they said they weren't treating her like an outsider, they weren't treating her like Hillary Clinton, they actually recycled the same contract that they gave to Hillary Clinton. And then we compared it because with censorship exposed, with our FOIA work, we asked for a lot of documents. And one of the documents that we asked for was the Hillary Clinton contract. We had done so months before, so we actually had it on file, which just worked out perfectly. And we actually discovered that for the Hillary Clinton event, which is a campaign rally, where you're going to have enormous, like thousands, well, we all know she didn't have thousands at her campaign rallies. But the idea was that there would be thousands of people there, right? They charged Hillary like $200 less than they were charging their own student who had every right to have her event free of charge. So again, this was for Spencer, just like a field day, and had the opportunity to go public with it. And this information, after going public, right, within 3 hours, the university folded. And the university rescinded this $500 charge. Within 3 hours, the university had received calls from alumni. They had received calls from members of their Board of Regents. And also the Lieutenant Governor of North Carolina heard about it, went to Facebook, and actually offered to pay the $500+ personally. Again, ridiculous. I don't know why they try to do this. They're not going to get away with it. Not when it's YAF involved, at least. All right, so I want to close our time here by talking about Berkeley. So this is Harmeet Dhillon, actually speaking right here. Harmeet is a phenomenal, phenomenal attorney, and she is representing Young America's Foundation in our lawsuit against Cal Berkeley. Many of you have probably heard about this lawsuit against Cal Berkeley. So a little background. In the spring semester, there were two events, two campus lectures that we attempted to host at Cal Berkeley. The first was on the topic of national security and radical Islamic terrorism. the university, rather than treat conservative students at Berkeley like every other student at Berkeley, the university said, well, you can have your event, but if you're going to have it, it's going to have to be a mile away from the center of campus to a location where students are actually going to have to take a shuttle to get to it. It's not going to be convenient for them. Then they said, we're going to impose a 3 p.m. curfew. Okay, you guys are college students. Who, a curfew? Come on. A 3 p.m. curfew. So your event has to be finished by 3 p.m. It's not that it has to start by 3 p.m., which means that this speech on radical Islamic terrorism would have had to start at 1 or earlier in order for it to be done. I mean, these are times when students are in class. And then this was my favorite restriction they imposed. They said, you cannot advertise the location of the event beforehand. Guys, that's like having a birthday party and telling all your friends, like, hey, you should come, you should give me a present, but part of it is, like, you have to guess where I am, right? It's crazy. It's absolutely crazy. Like, how could anyone be there? And then 6 days, so the students are at this point like, no, we're having this event. This is so important. Like, we're having this event. And 6 days before, the university said, we're going to charge you more than $5,000 in security costs for you to have this event. So at this point, what are the students to do, right? So at this point, we have to move on, because there's a subsequent event that's supposed to take place just weeks later. This next event was actually on the topic of immigration and immigration reform. And it was part of it was supposed to be a balanced approach to immigration, right? So you had a speaker come in that was sponsored by another organization to speak on a leftist liberal perspective. She was actually the former deputy chief of staff for President Clinton, certainly someone who I think would qualify as high profile. She gave a presentation in the evening hours on immigration. And then we had a speaker who was supposed to come in and speak on immigration, and the university blocked it. They said, absolutely not. You cannot bring in a speaker to talk on that issue. They refused to provide a room at all. And then when they got pressured from YAF and from you know, the media, when the story went viral, they said, oh, well, look how reasonable we are. We're going to give you a room to use, but it's going to be during dead week. Okay, it's going to be during the week when students are off campus. There are no classes taking place. It's the week that students are studying for exams. They're still going to be subject to a 3 p.m., I think, curfew. I think they were reasonable enough to go to 4 p.m. But the idea is here that they were still making sure that no students at Berkeley heard a conservative viewpoint on immigration. So at this point, we call Harmeet. I mean, this is ridiculous. We have to file a lawsuit against Berkeley. And it's not something that we do lightly. You know, we can send a demand letter threatening a lawsuit, we can send FOIA, we can go with the media, but it's a big deal to file a lawsuit against a school. And so we had to bring in one of the best First Amendment attorneys in the state of California. We found out that there was a high-profile speaker policy at the school. And we kind of knew this without having a label on it, because we experienced it, right? The policy imposed a curfew, 3 p.m. curfew, on speakers who were, quote, controversial. Let me just, on an aside, when you hear the word controversial at your campus, that just means it's a disfavored viewpoint, okay? There's nothing intrinsically controversial about conservative speech, right? It's just disfavored from the left. So you'll notice every time you advocate for conservative viewpoints on your campus, your administrators, your professors are going to erroneously label that as controversial as an attempt to justify their restrictions on your speech. They shouldn't get away with it. Let us know if they do it. Furthermore, this high-profile speaker's policy was selectively applied. So we did some research, okay? We found out that leftists were being able, were provided all sorts of opportunities to speak on campus. The former president of Mexico, they said, didn't qualify as a high-profile speaker, Vicente Fox. But yet our speakers triggered the policy. We found out in an LA Times interview that the chancellor of Cal Berkeley gave, her name is Carol Christ, she gave an interview where she said, just admitted, she said, look, in the past, especially in the 90s, when we had disfavored or controversial speakers come to campus, our response was always to make them give them a room that's really inconvenient for students to go to. We would impose a policy that they couldn't speak after a certain time of day. Wouldn't let them advertise. But then we were advised by counsel that we can't do that. What she failed to admit from the interview was when she was advised by counsel that she couldn't do that. Because if I'm looking at the facts, I'm saying, look, you admitted that you did it in the 90s, and you did it as recently as spring of 2017 as well. So can't do that, and we're suing you for it. Then that brings us up to speed to Ben Shapiro at Berkeley, which was a monumental success for conservative speech, something that with the foundation we're all very, very proud of, that event was such a success. So we brought in Ben to speak at Berkeley because over the summer, the university not only did they deny that the high-profile speaker policy existed, they said in their and this is only attorneys would say something like this. They said the policy doesn't exist, but to the extent that it did exist, it's been it's been changed by this new major events policy, which is basically the high-profile speaker policy, and they put a new label on it, right? And so this was a tactic they did to discredit our lawsuit. And that's all that it was. The effect is the same. They're still taking this unbridled discretion, as we call it in the law, this ability to determine who has free speech and who doesn't. So we had this event at Berkeley. Ben Shapiro spoke. They brought in all kinds of security for it. The news helicopters were there. The news agencies or publications were there as well. And then they brought her out. This woman is the vice chancellor of finance. And you know that she was just the one who lost in rock, paper, scissors. You kind of get this idea, like her relevance to this event is just non-existent. And it helps me sleep at night knowing that like Carol Crist and Joseph Greenwell and a few of these other folks at Berkeley were probably behind the scenes, you know, drawing straws or playing rock, paper, scissors to see who actually has to, you know, attend the YAF event. So she goes out and she says, we appreciate the voice of all the protesters at Berkeley, right? Their views, their expression is intrinsic to academics here at Berkeley. And whatever you hear from whoever comes in this platform next regarding removing protesters or those who would prevent this speech from happening, whatever you hear from them should not be taken as the official position of Cal Berkeley. In other words, like, she basically said, we love the protesters and we are so glad that you're here and we hope that you prevent this event from happening because we weren't able to this time. So where we're at now with Berkeley, today we filed an amended complaint in federal court. And in this amended complaint, we included the Ben Shapiro event because there were some violations of students' rights in this event as well. It's going to be a long process, so I hope that you'll watch New Guard and other publications to find out what's going on. But as I close, I want to leave you with seven situations. If you have pen and paper, seven situations when you know it's time to call YAF's legal team. Okay. First situation is security fees. Okay, so if you want to host a speaker at your campus, there's a good chance now that your administrators are going to assess a security fee on the event. And what's really important about this is how they come to the conclusion. What is part of the calculation, right? So we were recently contacted. A student at University of Texas Austin is getting ready to host an event. I think it's a Rick Santorum event. And the student was told verbally, you know, we do this on a content-neutral basis. We don't think about the content of what's being said in the speech when we're making this assessment. But having said that, can you explain why some of the statements by Rick Santorum are so controversial, and some of the reactions that he's had at other schools, like? On one side of their mouth, they're saying it's content neutral, but then subsequently, right after, they're clearly showing a content-based reason for imposing a security fee. Now, so watch out for security fees. Secondly, watch out for permit requirements, or what we call prior restraints on speech. This is the example from Alabama. Watch out for advertising restrictions, where they say you have to get approval to advertise something. Berkeley, actually, in their new policy, when they first released it, said that you have to give us 5 weeks' notice before you post an advertisement for your event. You have to give us 5 weeks' notice, even if that's an advertisement on Facebook or on Twitter or Snapchat, whatever it is. You have to give 5 weeks' notice. And then they quietly amended that to 2 weeks' notice, as if that's somehow better. It's still a prior restraint on speech. It's still unconstitutional. Selectively enforcing good policies. So even if they have a policy that's legal, that they're allowed to impose, if they're only imposing that on your chapter or on a conservative, or they're not doing it for liberal groups as well, that's also unconstitutional. They cannot do that. So call us. If there are speech zones on your campus, areas of campus where you can have free speech, which also means there are areas of campus where you cannot exercise your free speech, call us. We would love to challenge that. Where there are compulsory trainings, you might have to do a safe zone training where they teach you, you know, this is the language that you have to use, this is the pronoun that you have to use, and then they might ask you to sign an affirmative statement afterwards. If they have you do that, call us, because remember, to the beginning of this presentation, you have the freedom of speech. You also have the freedom not to say something that grieves your conscience or is something that's inconsistent with your beliefs. So they can't make you sign an affirmative statement, but we see that at schools. And then finally, if they deny recognition of your chapter, you have the right of assembly, guys. Don't let your university deprive you of that freedom either. That concludes my remarks. I'll definitely take some questions. All right. Do I select, or how does this work? We can start over here.
All right. Hi, I'm John from Liberty University.
Oh, fantastic.
I was actually curious about your opinion. There was a recent event at Liberty where LUPD removed a protester against Jerry Falwell's endorsement of Donald Trump. I was just curious about your opinion on that.
So you heard in the presentation that I'm an adjunct professor at Liberty, right? I don't know if I can... Okay, so let me take it this way. Okay, so it's a private school. So and I don't know all the facts. Honestly, I don't know all the facts of this situation. My understanding is that this was someone who was not affiliated with the university at all. It was not a student. It was not a professor. It was an outsider who came on campus. Because it is a private school, there are certain property rights that go along with that that are not the same if you go onto a public campus. Like if you were to walk onto Berkeley's campus as a Liberty student, you would have speech rights at Berkeley that you might not be able to exercise on private property elsewhere. So without going too far in the weeds and not knowing all the facts there, I would just remind that there is a distinction for what a university can do when it's private property as opposed to public property. But that, again, this is, a narrow situation where we're not talking about a student. Right. So, yeah. Next question.
Hey, my name is Sean from Washington State. I go to Whitworth University, and it's a private school as well. And so I was wondering what... protections private schools have versus public schools.
Okay.
As far as
protections from.
As far as like what can a private school prohibit us from doing that a state school wasn't allowed to.
Okay. Let me boil this down a little bit. With a private school, you'll notice there's a lot of codes of conduct that are going to be different, especially at faith-based schools. They might require that you abstain from certain behaviors that are inconsistent with the school's belief system. Okay, as a private school, this becomes a contract issue. Okay, so you're virtually signing a contract to attend that school, saying yes, I will abide by these rules that the school has as they pertain to my conduct in exchange for getting an education at this school. They have every ability to do that. Okay, a public institution does not. So a public institution can't require you to say something or to behave a certain way, provided that the behavior that you're trying to exert is not impeding the school's operation. Yeah.
Hi, my name is Lillian Bond, and I actually go to UT Austin.
Wonderful. Is it Rick Santorum?
It is Rick Santorum, where he's coming next Tuesday.
Wonderful.
So I was wondering, I know there are some actual restrictions on free speech, and obviously we want to be as much on the legal and right side of things as possible, so I was wondering if you could list off some of the restrictions on free speech that are actually legitimate.
Okay, sure. You can't go into a movie theater and yell fire. You can't do that. You're endangering others when you do that. And there is, you'll notice leftists, like Howard Dean went on however many, he just won't go away. He went on like several news programs and claimed that, you know, hate speech, whatever the universe, whatever leftists say is hate speech, whatever disagrees with their viewpoint, is somehow unprotected. That's not true. Where this comes into effect is speech that's likely to start an imminent violence. If there has to be this imminency component to it. Then that would be speech that could be restricted. But again, it's speech that's going to incite imminent violence can be restricted. Merely speech that is disfavored or disagreed with, that's 100% protected. And it doesn't matter how repugnant the administrators believe it to be. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Isaac Hampton from Truman State University in Missouri. What do you know about flag code?
I was never a Boy Scout. I don't know.
So what I'm getting at here is I'm also part of student government at Truman State University.
Okay.
And recently they put up an international flag display excluding the American flag. I'm kind of upset about that, but unfortunately I was the only person on student government who thought the American flag should be included. So okay. I was unable to get it in there.
Where is it being placed?
In the library. And the logic behind their thinking is this is for international students, therefore America shouldn't be included. And one person on the student government actually, when we were arguing about this, said, due to the recent NFL protests, we should not include it because then people might think that we're taking a stand there, you know? So I don't think there's any, like, legal thing we can do because it is student government money. It's not like
okay, so but let me kind of stop you right there. You also notice a lot of times, especially when it comes to funding for your events, that the decision is now being made by student government, right? And there's a wealth of case law that says that colleges may not get around their content neutral requirements and responsibilities simply by pawning off a responsibility to the students. They can't shift that responsibility to students to protect free speech and claim immunity from what the students are doing with funds. So, you know, this is a situation I probably want to look into a little bit more. I think putting a flag up certainly is communicative in nature. I think there's Supreme Court cases as well, especially involving flag burning, that is very clear that flags and what you do with flags carries a communication component to it. So maybe we can talk afterwards. I can get a little bit more information and we can move forward.
Sure.
Yeah, thanks.
Hey, I'm Taylor, if you don't know me. I'm the chairman of Saddleback Gaff, so we were featured. I just wanted to ask, and I wanted to update you all.
Featured.
The administration has now provided students with pamphlets and flyers that tell you where you can and cannot post things. And they've gone through the time to actually create case files for our chapter. So whenever we violate, they put us in like a little folder, and they keep it with them. So my question to you would be...
FOIA that folder.
What was that?
Oh, yeah. I might FOIA that folder. I'd love to see it.
Go for it. There's an administrator that goes and takes photos of our posting and then, like, prints it. So my question for you is the school continues to defend their argument that protecting aesthetic purposes of the campus is a good defense for a no-posting policy. Is that good or bad?
Yeah, I think more often than not, that's a pretty lousy excuse, honestly. I think the only really legitimate excuse that they can employ is safety. I think there are some courts who would disagree with that, but I think it's something that should be challenged nonetheless. You know, looking at Berkeley as an example of safety, just to show. So if a student group at Berkeley wants to host an event, they have to give, under the new policy, 8 weeks' notice to the school. regardless. So you could, if they want to, so if YAF wants to invite Ben Shapiro, 8 weeks notice. If a academic department wants to do so, 0 weeks notice. Okay, so is the safety threat any different? Of course not. It's the same speaker. It could be in the same venue, but safety is used as the really the strongest excuse by leftists. Okay,
thank you.
Yeah.
Good afternoon, Mr. Trammell. My name's Chase Howell. I go to the University of Michigan in Ann Arbor, and so recently, actually, yeah, just this week, we had the annual display of the Berlin Wall, you know, to commemorate its fall. And so I was just, you know, hanging around and having some conversations with people. And it eventually led to Richard Spencer, because he could possibly be coming to U of M to speak. And so the conversation kind of revolved around, you know, what rights does he have to do that? And obviously, you know, I was citing, well, you know, we've got laws on the books that obviously would restrict people from inciting violence from speaking, right? Because there are, you know, those restrictions. But it just really got me kind of thinking, you know, because I don't know a whole lot about, like, the specifics of what he advocates. I obviously know the general, you know, things that he says. But I was just wondering, you know, what would be your response to that? Like, to what extent would someone like Richard Spencer, do you think, have a right to speak? Or really what it kind of structured around was have a forum to do that, right? Like get allocated a room by the university, you know, with the views he has.
So a lot of this depends on how a university treats their facility from a legal perspective, you know, aside from how repugnant I think Richard Spencer is. If a university hosted or uses a room as a public accommodation, okay, so if it's open to the whole public, then there are certain rules where they can't restrict access to some and then grant access to others. I would have to review what the Michigan public accommodation rules are. A lot of times you see these laws come up when it comes to more social issues. For example, requiring a photographer or a baker to participate in a wedding ceremony that is inconsistent with their faith. So you see it in that regards as well. But when it comes to, you know, when you're dealing with public property, you're opening it up for the entire public. It's not facilities that are reserved for student use only. They really don't have the ability to discriminate on the basis of viewpoint. They wouldn't be able to say a pro-life group cannot use this auditorium because we as a university think that Roe v. Wade was awesome. They can't do that. So I think what you've seen with Richard Spencer is he's challenging in a lot of, I think there's two cases right now, one in, I think, Florida and one in Michigan, where he's challenging those laws. Yeah. You know, the First Amendment, it protects all speech with the narrow exceptions that we discussed earlier. So, for example, the Westboro Baptist folks who go to funerals for fallen soldiers, the Supreme Court says that that's protected speech if they're on a public sidewalk because that's a traditional public forum. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Brandon Albrecht. I'm the president of the University of Minnesota Morris College Republicans. Myself and the vice president have a radio show on the school's radio. And the show is called Deplorable Radio.
Deplorable Radio.
Yeah.
All right.
We talk politics and play some music and whatnot. But last week we were kicked off the radio. The student station manager came in with a cop and kicked us out because we had said the word tranny on the radio. She told us we had broken FCC law, and we had to go. And then they told us that we were permanently suspended from the radio. And we called them on it. We said that didn't break FCC law. You are presumptively allowed to be allowed to broadcast any word you want. But they changed it to, okay, you just broke the radio's policy as a club. Yeah. So we're just kicking you out of the club. And as a publicly funded institution, I was just wondering if they actually have the right to do that.
Okay, so the as a club, I think is interesting. So it's only a club that owns. Does the club own the broadband for the radio, or does the university own it?
I would say the university owns it and pays for it.
Yeah. Okay. So the university it shouldn't be restricting on the basis of viewpoint, and whether the usage of the word tranny violates in any way FCC. I would err to that it doesn't. There are certain words that you do get fined for saying on public airways. For example, if you were to start dropping a lot of F-bombs and whatnot, then that would be something that you could be, you know, punished for doing. But the word tranny, I don't see how that would classify.
They called it a threat. We just used it to refer to transgender people.
Yeah, I think for this question, I would want to review the context in which it was said. But we should definitely talk. I'll be here all weekend, so we should definitely talk this weekend. Okay. You know, just sit down and figure out what was really going on and what the best path forward would be.
Okay, yeah. Thank you.
All right, thank you very much.
Let's give Mark Trammell another round of applause. All right. Well, students, just a few announcements before we go check into the hotels. Ladies, you are all at the Avenida Hotel, and gentlemen, with a few exceptions, you are at the Best West.